good evening. My name is Christy Max Williams, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to this season concluding edition of the 22nd year of the Arts Café Mystic. We know it must be the end of our season because it's May. The charming month of May, as Robert Burns put it, or perhaps you know it better as the lusty month of May, which seems more appropriate for a month named after a Roman goddess, one of the many fertility goddesses, goddess of spring. Hoo-hoo for goddesses! Remember Shakespeare's Darling Buds of May. From one of the sonnets, darling from the Old English diminutive of dearling. Taking notes here. But the really erudite among you might recall from some long lost English class that it was Chaucer who coined it, the lusty month of May. And on such matters, Chaucer seemed to know what he was talking about. Remember the wife of Bath. So I hope we will all join with Chaucer in saying, hurrah for May and its lustiness. For those of you new to the Arts Café, our mission is to contribute to the lusty life of Southeastern Connecticut. What there is of it, yes. By presenting the nation's most celebrated poets and writers, along with New England's finest musicians, in programs that lift your spirits while deepening your minds. And if we have a little fun along the way, so much the better. And so to ensure that your lustiness won't be interrupted, would you please kindly take your cell phones out of your pockets or handbags and switch them off while we continue with our show. We would like to begin with our musical interlude tonight. We're delighted to welcome back some dear friends of the Arts Café. Ladies and gentlemen, if you are open to music that sways and swings and sometimes even slouches towards the sultry, the sexy, and the sophisticated, if you believe that you are man or woman enough for a bit of musical wit with a wiggle and a wink, then you are in for a treat, because tonight's musical interlude is served up by the Fred Molesky Quartet. Fred Molesky is celebrated as both a cabaret and classical singer with a repertoire that improbably spans jazz, musical theater, opera, oratorio, Celtic and sacred music. She's performed across the US, in Canada and Europe. And I might add that in another time, another lifetime perhaps, she even fronted a cool rock band. Ms. Molesky's quartet includes some of the finest players in New England. Some of you will remember them for having brought down the house in several previous ensembles at the Arts Café. They include Rufus Baby Grand Davis on the piano, the estimable Jim Hunter on bass, and the always on the upbeat John Moore on drums. So without more ado, won't you please join me in welcoming the Fred Molesky Quartet.
Thank you. glad to count myself as one of the ladies who sing with a band. I actually sing with about four bands. I actually have a country gig later on tonight, so how do you like that? Woohoo! Yeah. But anyway, but I'm glad to be singing with Fred and Friends, the Fred and Friends Jazz Quartet. And there is an ampersand crammed in there between Fred and Friends. Not between the hand and the hand, but... All right. Well, it's Friday, and you know what that means out on 95. So this is dedicated to anyone who's been stuck in traffic ever. A tune called Detour Ahead. It's more of a metaphor, not an actual traffic jam. Smooth road. Really? They couldn't come up with something better than that? Well, anyway, different times. 70 today. Woo! It's only almost June, but that's okay. It's finally happening. But you know, this is New England, so you know what's coming. You know what's coming. We go from winter straight to mosquitoes. So, yay. So here's a song about that. Not really. Not really. Just another metaphor, kind of.
Thank you.
been a public service announcement.
I don't know if they know this tune, Miss Wright.
Oh, I don't know.
Well, let's find out if they do. Okay. Right. I'm gonna watch lips moving for singing along and stuff.
I don't know if we know this tune, Miss
Wright. Your jazz musicians make it all.
But I studied at Juilliard.
I won't hold that against you.
Baby, shall we?
one more.
Good.
And this is it. But Erica Jong is in the house! We are very excited. Glad you made it. Were you traveling on I-95? Because that road is nasty. It's the worst. Oof.
At the Merritt Park.
Oh.
Oh.
At least that's sort of pretty, though. You don't see the like back end of all the city. But yeah. All right.
More call order.
It'll have to be the next time.
Okay.
But this is a nice tune, too. I have no idea who wrote this. I think it was a Frenchman by the name of Trené. I guess I do know who wrote it. Anyway.
Roll me a chord there, good sir.
Rufus Davis on the piano. And more than this.
The Arts Café has something a little special for you tonight. In addition to the adaptation, shall we say, we've undergone thus far, whereas we would usually present a Connecticut-based poet as our opening voice, we hope you'll forgive us in presuming that you would like to hear as much of our featured poet and writer as you can get. So we propose to present Erica Jong as tonight's opening voice, and that is how you pronounce the name, incidentally. She'll read, I think, first from her prose. Well, we'll see what she'll read from. And then in the second half of the program, we'll re-present her reading from her poetry. So let me get on with it here. For 45 years, Erica Jong has been a literary force of nature, producing novels, essays, memoirs, and poetry of the highest order. In our language, very few writers have written so well, so much, and in so many genres. D.H. Lawrence comes to mind, more recently John Updike, surely, but it is a very short list. The most basic accounting of Miss Jong's prodigious production literally speaks volumes, to date totaling 25 books, which have been translated into 43 languages, including 11 novels, 7 books of nonfiction, and 7 books of poetry, with another on the way. In the years to come, you may be confident that there will be truckloads of PhD dissertations written about Miss Jong's work and major biographies about her, shall we say, colorful life. Since publication of Fear of Flying, her cause celebre of a first novel, she has been an international literary star. Along the way, her work has earned her many awards and honors, including the United Nations Award for Excellence in Literature, France's Deauville Award for Literary Excellence, and Italy's Fernanda Pivano Award for American Literature. Moreover, as the first great literary voice of second-wave feminism, Jong has had a deep and lasting impact on culture. From her first published work and throughout her career, Erica Jong has blazed a trail that has left in its wake a container ship's cargo of taboos pertaining to female sensuality, and intelligence. That she has done so with wit and humor and panache has made her a hero among women and respected power among men. It has taken courage to confront a male-dominated culture. It has taken wit, humor, and strong brains to defang her adversaries and change that culture. With all this in mind, it is with a mix of pride and humility that the Arts Café invites you to welcome Erica Jong.
I hope you'll forgive me for getting here so late. I would rather have been a jazz singer. But I did leave New York at 3:30. Astounding. Anyway, thank you for that beautiful introduction. That was really amazing. And I wish it were true. Anyway. I thought it would be fun to read a little something about how I became a writer, and then talk a little bit about that, and then read poetry after. I have so many books of poetry, and the corporate publishers are busy putting them all out of print. Faster than you can say poem. And so, Well, it's the age of Amazon, okay? And the age of Trump. And the age of tweet. And it is not the age of poetry. However, I persevere. I always wanted to be a person of letters, which is a very antique thing to be. Writing poetry, writing fiction, writing essays. And I've become an antique, I think, for doing that. Anyway, I wanted to give you sort of something about me as a writer. I always knew I was a writer and that writing would define my life. This is from a book called Seducing the Demon, which is a memoir about my life as a writer. How I knew this, I can't say, but when I was 7, I used to kiss the pictures of writers on the backs of books. If I had known what I know now of writers, would I have done that? Probably not. Let me kiss the hand that wrote Ulysses, some abject fan once asked James Joyce. You don't know where else it's been, he said. I knew I loved writers. I vividly remember being a child in the big room on 77th Street, facing south over the water tanks of the Upper West Side, and lighted by the moon and the General Motors sign. I shared that room with both my sisters. Coming in to kiss us goodnight, my mother saw me kissing the picture of Louisa May Alcott on the back of Little Women. And she observed, ironically, she's dead. Probably she was jealous that I loved someone other than her. My mother's fierce, envious love left no room for other women mentors. But her throwaway comment made writing seem even more miraculous. The dead could still communicate? I adored writers because even from the grave, they were able to take me away on magical voyages. The books I treasured as a child, the Oz books, Ozma of Oz was my favorite, At the Back of the North Wind, Gulliver's Travels, were all about such voyages. And not surprisingly, the form I revert to again and again is a picaresque in which a lucky naïf encounters all sorts of baddies, but nevertheless makes it alive to a happy ending. I never planned this plot, but its template must be embedded in my unconscious. I write such books, I guess, because I cherished such stories when I was young. And I write always in the hopes of being transported to some enchanted place. I need the process of writing to keep me from going mad. Or perhaps it was all Oedipal, a way of seducing my father by becoming famous. Fame was a thing he prized. If I became famous, he would love me best of the three sisters. My father, by the way, was a songwriter who gave up songwriting because he said, I knew I wasn't Irving Berlin, and I knew I wasn't Cole Porter, so why bother? But he did. He was in show business. He played the drums. He played the piano. We never lived anywhere without a set of drums and a piano. But what he really wanted was to be Cole Porter or Irving Berlin or the wonderful author of Satin Doll, which you just heard. And that was his wish. And so I always think people who can play music and sing are much better than writers. And I'm sorry I'm not one of them. Anyway, so there's always a problem in life, right? Let's face it. Okay. Fame was the thing my father prized. Perhaps it was as simple and complex as that. If I were a child today, would I be equally in love with books? My daughter was a television watcher who came late to books, but is now a convert, and a writer, and my grandson is already book obsessed, and my granddaughter walks around with a novel in front of her face at 8, and she puts down the iPad so she can read fantasy novels. You know, the kids, she's only 8, but she reads these YA novels that take place in sacred forests and things. Anyway, and the other grandson is also a reader. I mean, they're all readers. It's a curse, I think. Anyway, my first grandson used to say, when I came over to the house and when he was 2, he would say, "Read, read," and hand me an unruly stack of books. Perhaps the reading addiction cannot be suppressed. I hope not. We live in a world so full of willful distractions that it seems unlikely that pursuits as solitary as reading can survive. In airports, in gyms, in banks, in diners, in manicure parlors, TV news assaults you. On the telephone, you are obliged to listen to music you would never choose. Cell phone junkies, including me, tell you the details of their dinners, dynastic complications, and medical disorders you don't want to know about. All your senses scream for serenity. Perhaps paradoxically, that is why writing has never been so important, despite the fact that fewer and fewer people have time to read. Writing and reading enable you to reclaim the inside of your skull. It's true. And they erase the slate scribbled with distractions. For me, it is a kind of meditation. I am never so calm as after I have written. And the next morning, I will feel the familiar anxiety and will have to begin the process all over again. Henry Miller used to say that he wrote 50 pages before he could hear the book's fetal heartbeat. Ernest Hemingway, that great overrated icon, used to look out over the rooftops of Paris and say to himself, "All you have to do is write one true sentence. Write the truest sentence you know." We make ourselves real by telling the truth, the poet, monk, philosopher Thomas Merton says. And for me, that is the secret of writing. To be able to make yourself real by telling the truth, to find a place where you can tell the truth in a world absolutely stuffed with lies. And I think that is really the need to write. At least for me, it always has been. And the reason that I'm a satirist as well as a romantic is because I have to make fun of the world in which I find myself. I think satire is a way of surviving, really. So that's just a little introduction to me as a writer. Thank you for coming.
Some of you have asked how the Arts Café succeeded in engaging Erica Jong. It makes for a good story. On New Year's night, 2015, Kate and I were dinner guests of Betty Metzger and John Racinelli. Dear friends who live in New York and have a place here in Mystic, I invoke their names because they wanted very much to be here and are both a little under the weather. Some of you will recall that Betty Metzger read here at this podium from her powerful book, The Burglary. At that table, at their table that night, was a man named Bob. HIPAA compliance constrains me from divulging his full name. Upon learning from Betty and John, our host, about my role in the Arts Café, Bob asked me if I had ever read any of Erica Jong's poetry. Yes, I replied. To which he asked immediately if the Arts Café might be interested in presenting Ms. Jong. Sure, I said, being both curious and skeptical. Bob explained why he knew Erica, and that he was a longtime friend of hers and would make inquiries. Well, some weeks passed, and I thought nothing more about it. Lots of people tell me they know famous writers. But one day I received a call from Betty, who said that Bob had paved the way for me to call Erica Jong. And so I did, with some trepidation. I mean, she's Erica Jong, after all. The woman I spoke to that day was wonderfully warm, generous, gracious, and funny. Turns out she had sailed into Mystic on several occasions. Imagine! Turns out she was working on a new book of poems and would love to read at the Arts Café. Imagine! No, she couldn't do October because she had to go to Italy to present her new novel, Fear of Dying. I said, sure, I understand. So here we are. So that's how we got Erica Jong, but it's not why we wanted her. Erica Jong is first and foremost a poet. It's how she thinks of herself. It's what she said to me in that first conversation, and what she has said and written in public. In 1973, at the time of the publication of Fear of Flying, Ms. Jong had already published two books of poems that had immediately established her as one of the most important poets of her generation. And the big new voice of second wave feminism. Her first book of poems, called Fruits and Vegetables, is perhaps the most auspicious debut I know of since Wallace Stevens' Harmonium. What is more, the title poem of that book, Fruits and Vegetables, is surely one of the great poems of the 20th century. From the first, Erica Jong's poems were startling for their originality and joy of language and thought. Over the years, her output of poetry has been steady and vast, consistently exploring the great Jongian themes, forgive me, of eros, of course, mortality, but above all, the sheer interest and pleasure to be taken in life. Oh yes, there is in her poetry the same intensive attention to female sensuality that is the hallmark of her fiction. And the drama of sex is always lurking. But as a poet, she has a wide arsenal of metaphor, wit, poetic tradition, and formal devices to make something new, surprising, and original of this stuff. With candor and humor, Jong has also used her poetry to report the inevitable changes brought on by aging. Has any woman ever written so candidly about the changes the years of age made to her face and body? I don't think so. Has any poet of any age written with such a light but powerful touch about physical passion? Though her cultural impact will endure, though Fear of Flying and maybe Fanny could persist, it is Erica Jong's poetry that will surely be read and studied in generations to come. And this is why the Arts Café takes such pride in introducing again Erica Jong.
Well, that's pretty lovely to hear. And the reason that I came is because I love poetry. And I think it's the source of everything. It's certainly the source of everything I do in my work. I wouldn't have the passion for language if I hadn't written poetry. It's also that poetry makes you go down into the unconscious, to that part of you where the dreams and the visions come from. And I don't think that without having written poetry, I would write fiction, because it is the source of everything in the arts, I think. So it's very strange to me. My reputation is, I loved that book. What do you do? Young women come up to me and say, I loved that book. I was on a Greek island and I was backpacking with my best friend from college, and I had that book in my backpack, and it was underlined, and I had exclamation points in the margins, and then I was drinking ouzo or retsina with this boy, and his eyes were big and brown like olives floating in olive oil. And he had a mass of curly brown hair, and he was all suntanned, and I was reading Fear of Flying, and, well, Erica, thank you. So that book has overwhelmed absolutely everything in my life. And for a long time, I remember being sort of mad about it. You know, promising younger poet, reviewed in Poetry Magazine, wins Best Hokan Award, also won by Sylvia Plath. And here I am. It's that book. And sometimes a young man will come up to me and say, I was reading Fruits and Vegetables to a young lady that I had met in a bar at Brandeis. And I was reading her a poem, Goodbye, he said, entering the apple, which is the first line of one of my Fruits and Vegetables poems. And as I read her the poems, we sort of climbed into bed together. And Erica Jong, thank you. What am I going to do? And then there are the Asian American men who come up to me and say, they used to think we were nerds and we just had a pocket full of pen protectors. But because of Fear of Flying and Bennett Wing, we are now sex objects. That book. Okay, so, all right, so that has been my life, and now I think it's funny and quite sweet. 43 years later, I think, well, it gave me my nom de plume. It gave me my ability to make a living as a writer, although it gets less and less and less in the age of Amazon. But it's funny that book, and it's still, you know, people still talk to me about that book. Okay, I'm going to start with a poem sort of inspired by Pablo Neruda. It's called Ode to My Shoes. You may know that Pablo Neruda wrote odes to artichoke, odes to cabbages, and I thought, why not take a homely object like shoes and write about it? Pablo Neruda wrote an ode to socks, so he inspired me. The poet alone is writing an ode to her shoes. her shoes which only she can fill, her shoes of purple suede and green leather, the color of palm fronds, her diamond-studded boots, her feathered cowboy boots, her flame cowboy boots, her seven-league epic poetry boots with the little silver haiku boots, with the tiny heels that twinkle, her first-person platform boots, and her backless glass slippers modeled after Cinderella's, one lost at midnight because of a running man, her huntress boots of India rubber, her lover's boots joined at the ankle like leg irons, her pink baby booties bronzed for posterity, her daughter's burning Reeboks, her lover's laceless sneakers left in the guest room closet for her to kiss year after year after year. Darling shoes, beloved feet, 10 toes to walk me toward my true love, me pumps to fuel his passion, stiletto heels to stab him when he strays. Shoes tell you everything. Shoes speak my language. Their tap, tap, tap on the airport runway tells me the story of a lovely, lonely woman flying after love. That old, old story in a new pair of shoes. It's really kind of funny. I mean, this is my selected, new and selected poems. And I'll read you some examples from this book, which I really do love. When I was a little kid, I always loved the story of Persephone. And you know the story of Persephone. Demeter has a daughter, Demeter or Gaia or whoever you wanted, the goddess of fertility and that makes the trees grow and plants blossom. She is Isis to the Egyptians. And whenever I hear the word Isis for a terrorist group, I feel just absolutely terrible, because when Isis shed a tear, the Nile Valley was irrigated and things grew. And so Isis, who is also Ishtar, who is also Gaia, who is also Demeter, who is also Mother Mary, by the way, who fecundates, all of these goddesses are really the same. And if you study the history of religion, you see that they inspire each other. Anyway, Demeter, the Greek name for the goddess of plenty, has a daughter whom she loves more than life itself, and her daughter is Persephone. And one day, the lord of the underworld, Hades, sees Persephone, falls in love with her, and takes her down to his kingdom, the underworld, the kingdom of the shades, the kingdom, it's not hell in our sense, it's the land of the dead in the ancient Greek sense. Okay, so Hades has captured her beloved daughter, and Persephone, the daughter, makes the mistake. You know, in legends, if you eat something in a kingdom, you're tied to that kingdom. So Hades takes out something like 12 pomegranate seeds and offers them to Persephone. And Persephone eats 6 of them. Big mistake. And by ingesting the seeds, a promise is made. So Demeter comes and rescues her daughter, but Hades makes a bargain and says, but she ate 6 pomegranate seeds, so she must spend 6 months with me each year. And during the 6 months that she spends with her mother, Demeter, which means the mother, really, in Greek, all the plants wilt, and fall comes, and winter comes, And in the spring, Persephone comes from Hades and spends time with her mother again, and everything blooms and grows as it does now in beautiful green Connecticut. And then in the fall, she goes back to Hades and everything wilts. So this was the Greek myth of the seasons, but it was also a mother-daughter story, a very profound mother-daughter story. Oh, the Greeks were so smart. Demeter at dusk. At dusk, Demeter becomes afraid for baby Persephone lost in that hell which she herself created with her love. Excess of love, the woman's curse, the curse of loving that which causes pain, the curse of bringing forth in pain, the curse of bearing always pain. Demeter pauses, listening for her child, this fertile goddess with her golden hair, bringing forth wheat and fruit and wildflowers knee-high, this apple-breasted goddess whose sad eyes will bless the frozen world, bring spring again, walked through the night and loved a man, half-demon, angel-tongued, who gave her everything she needed to be wise, a daughter, hell's black night, then endless spring. So that is, you know, how the seasons came to be and how women and daughters came to be. It's very hard to have a daughter, I'll tell you. I have one. She's given me these three fabulous grandchildren. But, you know, the poet W.D. Snodgrass said, an only daughter is a needle in the heart. Nobody said it better. I wish I'd said that. But my daughter has paid me back for every rotten thing I did to my mother. And now she and I are almost best friends. But note the almost. Anyway, that reminds me, I'm going to read you a poem that I wrote when I was pregnant with her. Ordinary miracles. Spring, rainbows, ordinary miracles about which nothing new can be said. The stars on a clear night of a New England winter. The soft air of the islands along the old Spanish main. Pirate gold shining in the palm. The odor of roses to a lover's nose. There is no more poetry to be written of these things. The rainbow's sudden revelation. Behold, the cliche is true. What can one say but that? So too with you, little heart, little miracle. But you are no less miracle for being ordinary. The birth of the water baby. Little egg, little nub, full complement of fingers, toes, little rose blooming in a red universe which once wanted you less than emptiness, but now holds you fast, containing your rapid heartbeat under its slower one as the earth contains the sea. Oh, avocado pit, almost ready to sprout, tiny fruit tree within sight of the sea, little swimming fish, little land lover, hold on, hold on. Here under my heart you'll keep till it's time for us to meet, and we come apart that we may come together, and you are born remembering the wave sound of my blood, the thunder of my heart, and like your mother, always dreaming of the sea. I remember that when I first went for an examination when I was pregnant, I heard the sounds inside the body, which sounded like the sea beating. And I thought, oh, that's why we love the sea, because we remember being in the womb and hearing that sound. So I think I had this great aperçu when I was pregnant with Molly. But it is quite a miracle to be a poet and a woman. And it is quite a miracle. And it's really tough, because the feeling that men have about women poets has still not gotten better. It's true. Anyway, those are some of the poems that I wrote when I was pregnant with Molly. And one more of those poems, Love Spell Against Endings. I had been single for about 8.5 years, and I never wanted to get married again. Never, 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 never. And I have this beautiful house in Connecticut, and I had a house in New York, and I had various boyfriends, one who looked good in a tux, and one who liked to talk about literature. And I thought, who needs a husband, for God's sake? It's fine, you know, it's just fine. And then after about 8.5 years of this, and being the breadwinner as a writer, which is like, nowadays it's impossible. At that time, you could get those $1 million advances and invest them. Thank God I didn't spend it all on shoes. Anyway, I started to get a bit lonely. I always had the three boyfriends, you know. And after a while, that began to get old, as it does. And I thought, I need one guy, right? But they're all so awful. I mean, there's no way. So I thought, what will I do? I will sit in my hot tub in Connecticut, and I will cast a spell for a man who can be everything to me. And I wrote this poem. This is the spell, Love Spell Against Endings. All the endings in my life rise up against me like that sea of troubles, Shakespeare mixed with metaphors. Like Vikings in their boats singing Wagner, like witches burning at the stake, I submit to my fate. I know beginnings, their sweetnesses, and endings, their bitternesses, but I do not know continuance. I do not know the sweet demi-boredom of life as it lingers, of man and wife regarding each other across a table of shared witnesses, of the hand-in-hand dreams of those who have slept a half century together in a bed so used and familiar, it is rutted with love. I would know that before this life closes, a soulmate to share my roses. I would make a spell with long gray beard hairs and powdered rosemary and rue, with the jacket of a tux for a tall man with broad shoulders who loves to dance, with one blue contact lens for his bluest eyes, with honey in a jar for his love of me, with salt in a dish for his love of sex and skin, with crushed rose petals for our bed, with tubes of cerulean blue and vermilion and rose madder for his artist's eye, with a dented Land Rover fender for his love of travel, with a poem by Blake for his love of innocence revealed by experience, with soft rain and a bare head and hand-in-hand dreams on Mondays and the land of on Sundays, with mangoes, papayas, and limes, and a house towering over the sea. Muse, I surrender to thee. Thy will be done, not mine. If this love spell pleases you, send me this lover, this husband, this dancing partner for my empty bed, and let him from now until I die. I offer my bones, my poems, my luck with roses, and the secret garden I have found walled in my center, and the sunflower who raises her head despite her heavy seeds. I am ready now, Muse, to serve you faithfully, even with a graceful dancing partner, for I have learned to stand alone. Give me your blessing. Let the next epithalamion I write be my own, and let it last more than the years of my life, and without the least strain, two lovers bareheaded in the summer rain. So he turned up, Kenneth David Burroughs, my husband of 28 years, who is now in Western Connecticut, where we still, you know, have the same house I've had for 40 some years. Because why did I buy a house in Connecticut? I thought that when you became a writer, you were required to buy a house in Connecticut. So the first real money I made as a writer, I bought this house in Connecticut. I thought, you know, that's what you have to do. And the reason I did that was because early in my life as a writer, a man named Louis Untermeyer wrote me a fan letter. Does anybody remember Louis? Yes. And he edited all the poetry anthologies of my youth, all the ones we read in school and stuff. And he wrote to me. I had published a series of poems in something called the Beloit Poetry Journal. And I published them under my maiden name, Erica Mann. And he wrote to me and said, "What are you doing in this mass of mediocrity? You're the real thing." And then he began inviting me to Newtown, Connecticut, where he had a house, and really an incredible barn full of first editions. Every first edition published over the last, he was 90 when I met him, so over the last 80 years. And he had a little pond, which he called Lake Inferior. And and it was at that house in Newtown, Connecticut, where I met Arthur Miller, Ingham Rath, and Muriel Rukeyser, and all the great poets who were still alive at that time. So I thought, when you become a writer, you must have a house in Connecticut. And I still have that house. Amazing. And we still go there every weekend, except when the weather is too horrible. So, okay, so I have a house in Connecticut. How did I get there? Which is sort of interesting. I'm going to read you a couple of new poems. It's hard to digest poems if you don't have the text in front of you. So I'm not going to read you tons and tons of poetry because it's too hard to absorb. However, there is one poem I would like to read in particular. It's called Child on the Beach. I've been very moved by the fact that Sappho's island, the island of Mytilene, has been a landing place for Syrian refugees. You know, one of the reasons that Sappho's island, Mytilene, or Lesbos, was so important in the ancient world was because it was 2.5 kilometers from what is now the coast of Turkey, which in those days was the kingdom of Lydia, ruled by Croesus, who the gold came down the rivers, and he was very rich because gold was there. Okay. And Sappho's island has been where all these Syrian refugees, and often their children, and often their drowned children, have turned up. And I wrote a novel about Sappho called Sappho's Leap. And I find it, and I know a lot about her and a lot about ancient Greece because I had to do my homework to write that novel. Do you remember the pictures of a little dead child of three thrown up on the beach? And later we learned his name. And okay, so this is the poem I wrote about that child thrown up on the beach of Sappho's Island. And the poem was published by Haaretz, the Israeli paper, which is one of the only places in the world that publishes a poem a day. And they published it in Hebrew and in English, Child on the Beach. The Mediterranean is black with bodies, as in the time of the Trojan Wars, when Homer sang of bloody battles and heroes lay unburied beneath the topless towers of Troy. But this little boy of three sleeps unburied on a beach. Where is he from? The chemical fog of Syria, the garbage dumps of beautiful Beirut, the chaos of civilization come undone. He rests, his parents lost, his sisters drowned, his brother thrown up on another beach. What shall I do with this dead toddler who breaks me open to grief? I will adopt him, my nameless grandson, welcome him into my shattered breast, his death so sweet even the Nereids and cherubs weep, and Nereids float him in their seaweed boats. Little one, now you are mine. Sleep in my arms while I sing you this lullaby. Maybe you'll waken in a kinder world where children don't die at the edge of the sea. Meanwhile, dream of peace for this broken world. One of the crazy things that happens when you become a grandmother is that all the children in the world become yours. You can't look at a picture of a child, a dead child on a beach, without saying, it could be mine. And this is why I believe that grandmothers should be in charge of when we go to war, which the native the Native American peoples who were indigenous to this country, the women didn't fight the wars. Margaret Mead once said, I wouldn't have women fight wars because they are too fierce. Whatever. But the Council of Grandmothers decided on war and peace in the Native American cultures. The braves fought the war, but the grandmothers decided when there would be war and when there would be peace. Tell that to Hillary Clinton, please. Tell it to Donald Trump, somebody. Anyway, I think we have to go back to that system. Because who knows how life is, how precious life is, but grandmothers, having seen it all, you know? Anyway, that sounds like female chauvinism, but it's not meant to be. I do love men as well. So I have fallen in love with an Argentinian writer, not Argentinian, I'm sorry, Brazilian writer called Clarice Lispector, who wrote in Portuguese. And she's one of the great undiscovered women of, she died 20 years ago. And she wrote the most incredible short stories and novels. And like many South American writers, she blended the essay and the short story. And she was incredible, Clarice. And if you go on the streets of Brazil, of Rio, or another city, and you say Clarice, they say, oh, our poet, our great writer, Clarice. So I've been in love with her, and every time I read one of her books, I write poetry. The breathing of the world. The world's continual breathing is what we hear and call silence. I hear the breathing of the world, the muffled screams of the hungry, the dance of anger in the lungs, the sharp intake of breath when danger comes. I hear the beautiful breathing of babies, the moaning of mothers giving birth, the low susurration of lovers cooing like doves, the leaves greenly breathing of spring, the snowflakes breathing silent snow. Breath is what lets us know we are alive. Breath is love, is affirmation, is spirit stretching out to bless the flesh. Breath is blessing. Even in silence, we are blessed. I came to understand when my mother died at 101, what was life and what was death. Life is breath. And when the breathing stops, we call it death. When my mother died finally at nearly 101, she was so ready. She was ready to go. She was not fighting it. She was ready. And I saw that, and it made me far less afraid than I had ever been of death. People sometimes come to a moment of completion. I wrote about this in Fear of Dying, my last novel. She had had it. She had done everything. She had multiple grandchildren. She had painted more paintings than you could hang on the walls. She was completely ready. And when my sister and I came, we were called by her nurse. And we came across town, and she had just passed, as people say. Her cheek was warm. And we stood there, and we blessed her. We had had, you know, she was difficult, and we had had fights. But in the last several years of her life, all we did was sit and hold each other and say, I love you, I love you, I love you. That was it. So I was there the day before she died. And I was wearing something very brightly colored. And she rose up out of bed, she was a painter, as if to say, I like that purple and red blouse you're wearing, or whatever it was. And she hugged me, and I hugged her. And the next day she was gone. And my father, on the other hand, and I've written about this a bit in Fear of Dying, my latest novel, which I really love. My father thought if he stayed on the treadmill every morning and every night, and if he ate kale, a lot of kale, and if he drank apple cider vinegar and took multiple quantities of vitamin C, vitamin D, vitamin this, vitamin that, he was a health food nut, my father. My mother ate chocolate. So my father died at 93, my mother at 101, whatever. But her thing was chocolate and his thing was kale. And the other thing that I noticed, he was so angry at dying. He was not ready. Even at that age, he beat multiple forms of cancer. He was healthy. He had his brain. He didn't have memory loss. But he really didn't want to go. And so he would eat all his health food. He would work out on the treadmill in the morning and work out in the treadmill at night. And he really thought if he kept running on the treadmill, he'd never die. My mother, on the other hand, accepted the universe. I hope I will be that way. Who knows? But watching them, and they were lovers from the time they were teenagers, and they had a very difficult and yet very loving marriage, which I now have with Ken. They set that pattern, God help us. But what I can say about them was they adored each other. And I used to hear in my bedroom, I'd be in my bedroom and I'd hear them reading S.J. Perelman in the New Yorker aloud to each other and roaring with laughter. And I always wanted a marriage like that, that was full of laughter. That was the model they set. And I think it's pretty good, because if you can laugh with somebody, almost anything, you can get through almost anything. And he's funny, Ken is funny. But I guess I wanted to read you the poem about breath, because it seems to me that breathing and losing the ability to breathe is really what it's about, you know? If you talk about, I mean, death is not scary, and you'll see if you read Fear of Dying, it's not a frightening book, it's a funny book, and it's an ironic book about life and death. And I think that as we get older, we're also afraid of getting older, but as we get older, we really understand life better. And I wouldn't have missed it for the world. I wouldn't have missed the grandchildren. I wouldn't have missed being there when my parents went. I wouldn't have missed any of it. And I have this sense now of life as a celebration. I always thought life was a celebration. And I also thought life was a tragedy, of course. Anyway, so one more and then we finish. This is my mother. Dying is not black. Touch, words, color. My expiring mother notices the red and purple of my shirt with delight. Color is her language, though she taught me both painting and poetry, interlocking languages for her and now for me. She has no words for my shirt, but exclaims nonsense syllables of joy, her only brush now for the ecstasy of red, the blue note of mauve over it, making plum. Her sounds become a damson jam like her mother's, sweet but muddled. Her love is clear. Her love assails my eyes as if it were blood glittering on a knife, aiming for my heart. Thank you so much.
Erica Jong, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Erica. That was wonderful. Thanks also to the Fred Molesky Quartet. For those of you who would like to take Erica Jong home with you tonight, we would propose instead that you take a couple of her books, which she would be delighted to sign for you. The Arts Café will return in September. Have a good summer, and remember that the Arts Café is a tribute to you. This is community, my friends, and doesn't it feel good? Good night. Thank you.